So far in this series, you've learned why to do CEAs and key elements of how: the incremental cost-effectiveness ratio, DALYs and QALYs, sensitivity analyses, and other issues. In the last segment, you learned how to present CEA in a research proposal. In this segment, we will look at decision trees for CEA. We have a few introductory comments and then a short animation on the use of decision trees to structure your analysis. The decision tree is a great tool for cost-effectiveness analysis because it's designed to show potential options for action and the consequences of those options. Trees structure the analysis and guide calculations. I love decision trees as a way to structure analysis. Some of my colleagues say, "I'm a tree hugger." I am. They are so helpful. You can do CEAs without trees, but in this series we highlight the tree approach. There are three major components of a decision tree: action options, which show the decision being considered; consequences, which describe the mix of outcomes and their probabilities; and the value of health and cost outcomes for each set of consequences. Once you have these in a tree, you can calculate the expected value of each action option for health and cost outcomes, and you can determine your cost-effectiveness ratio to make better decisions about health spending. Let's look at an example. Here's a basic decision tree to assess the cost-effectiveness of a mobile camp for adult male circumcision in rural Zambia to prevent HIV infection. This is a simplified version of the research question in segment number 7. You start with a description of the population. In this instance, young men at risk of acquiring HIV infection. Let's say we have 100 such men. You can portray any number of individuals, but it's easier to show and understand the calculations if you use a large round number like 100 or 1,000. This square represents a decision node, the choice of no camp versus a circumcision camp. As we've said, CEA always examines a comparison. Here, the comparison option is doing no camp. So in this tree, all 100 men go to either no camp or circumcision camp. The subsequent branches show what happens as a result. Next comes this circle, which is a chance node. Chance nodes show the mix of possible consequences for each option. In this simple tree, there is only one chance node per option. In most trees, there are many branching chance nodes. For learning, we'll keep it simple. The upper chance node shows that with no circumcision camp, the likelihood of getting HIV infection is 0.4, or 40%. So the chance of not getting HIV infection is 60%. These probabilities always add up to 1. It's best for chance nodes to be dichotomous, like this one, to facilitate sensitivity analyses. But it's also okay to show 3 or more mutually exclusive outcomes in one chance node. With a circumcision camp, the chance of HIV infection is specified as 20%. This is based on 3 excellent clinical trials, which show that circumcision lowers the risk of HIV infection by 50%. Half of 0.4 is 0.2. Thus, the likelihood of no HIV infection is 80%. This is the core structure of the decision tree: action options followed by chance nodes, which represent consequences. Next, we want to calculate how many individuals end up following each path in the tree. Remember that we started with 100 individuals. So if, with no camp, the chance of HIV infection is 0.4, the number in that path is 40, which equals 100 times 0.4. Similarly, the number not getting HIV infection is 60. Thus, all 100 men who started that option follow one of these 2 tree paths. Below, with circumcision camp, the 100 men are divided into 20 who get HIV infection, that's 100 times 0.2, and 80 who do not. The difference between action options in these outcomes, HIV infection or not, drives both health and cost outcomes for the analysis. This could be said more generally: the differences in the distribution of clinical outcomes influences CEA results. Next, we need to attach DALYs to each path. The added DALY burden due to each new HIV infection is estimated at 7, based on studies that portray health status over time with and without HIV infection, allowing for the use of antiretroviral therapy. Thus, we put 7 next to paths with HIV infection and 0 next to paths without HIV infection because no DALYs are incurred with no HIV infection. We calculate the expected DALYs due to HIV in each path as the product of the number of individuals in the path times the DALYs. For the no camp option with HIV infection, that is, the first path in the tree, we calculate 280 DALYs as the product of 40 and 7. The next path, no camp and no HIV infection, has no DALYs in the absence of HIV infection. Thus, the total of galleys for the no camp equals 280. For the circumcision camp paths, we similarly calculate 140 and 0 galleys respectively, for a total of 140 galleys with the camp. Thus, the circumcision camp averts an estimated 140 galleys per 100 individuals. That's the health benefit. Adding costs to each path is a very similar process. There are two types of costs. First is the cost to implement the circumcision camp, usually referred to as program or intervention cost. This is $100 per person with the camp and $0 with no camp. The second type of cost is for HIV medical care, required for individuals who become HIV infected. Based on empirical and modeling studies in Africa, we estimate this at $6,000. The total cost for each path is a sum of circumcision camp and HIV medical care costs, multiplied by the number of individuals in that path. In the first path, which is no camp followed by HIV infection, the estimated total cost is $240,000, which is the product of $40,000 and $6,000. The next path has zero cost since there is no camp and no HIV infection. Thus, total cost for no camp equal $240,000. For the circumcision camp part of the tree, the cost with HIV infection is $122,000, representing mainly the HIV care costs, but also camp costs. The cost with no HIV infection is $8,000, representing 80 individuals and $100 per person for the camp. The total for the circumcision camp part of the tree is $130,000. Thus, the camp saves $110,000 per 100 participants. Since the camp reduces galleys and also saves money, we say it is dominant, both better and cheaper. By the way, the best evidence for male circumcision definitely supports the idea that you save more money than you spend. Thus, as we can see in this table, male circumcision is an efficient strategy. Let's step back to consider what we did with the decision tree. We compared two action options, portrayed the probability of key disease outcomes, and attached galleys and money to those outcomes. Thus, we arrived at the expected galleys and costs for each action option. However, real decision trees aren't as visually elegant as in this video. Here we see an Excel version of the decision tree. This has a look that is more typical of a real analysis. If the camp didn't save money but did improve health, that is, decreased galleys, we'd calculate the ICER as the difference in total cost divided by the difference in galleys. But when an intervention is dominant, we don't calculate the ICER. See in this modified tree a hypothetical example if the camps were much more expensive, $250 per client, and lifetime medical costs were only $1,000. With those assumptions, the ICER would be $36. Now you know how decision trees work. Adding more action options or a more complex set of outcomes is conceptually the same, just with added detail. Any CEA can be structured this way. I hope you too become a tree hugger.